Welcome to Reluctantly Supernatural in an Age of Reason, the podcast where we explore the place of the supernatural gifts of the Holy Spirit in our lives and in the church. Our hosts, Pastors Mark Cowper-Smith and Bob Maddox, combine their years of ministry experience to address the issues of the prophetic gifts in our modern world. Join us as they interview their guests from a wide variety of spiritual leadership backgrounds, as they share their insights on the place of the supernatural in the church and the world. And now, our hosts, Mark Cowper-Smith and Bob Maddox.
Welcome, everybody, to the third part of our interview with Les Meredith, amazing guy, an attorney, and an on-fire Christian. Mark's going to explain about this next session.
Well, this is the third in our podcast with Les. And let me just look at my notes. This one is really, really extraordinary. He talks about an experience praying for a neighbor's son with a very, very badly broken arm. Quite exciting testimony. I think you're going to love it. But it brings some really, really good questions to mind, which we're going to ask Les and talk about at the end of the podcast. So let's listen to Les, lawyer turned healer, Christian healing ministry. Let's turn it over to Les and find out what he has to say.
It seems to me that you're not somebody that's following signs, right? You know what I mean by that?
Yeah.
Can you explain that to maybe somebody thinking, well, that's just a guy, he's caught up in signs.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure. The gifts are from the giver. And a sign, according to the book of John, always points to something else, which is the giver. You know, a sign and a wonder is something that makes you go, huh? And then you look over at the source, which is Jesus Christ. And there are people who just go from revival to revival to watch people fall down or to hope they get someone that'll prophesy over them. And their life is spent trying to hear God through someone else. But God spent his time writing down a whole manual for us that says, come to me first. It's through me and your love of me that you're going to experience these things. And then when God gives you a gift, it's not really for you. It's for you to give to someone else. So that you can get lost chasing the signs and wonders because they're so amazing. But if you lose track of Jesus, you've lost track of the whole thing. And eventually your signs and wonders, you know, there's a book in Matthew that Jesus says, you're going to come to me at the end of the time and say that you cast out demons in my name and you perform miracles in my name, but I never knew you, so go away. So, you know, there's power in the declaration of the truth of God. The power of the word to speak a miracle in Jesus' name can trigger a miracle because it's Jesus' name, not because you know Jesus, not because you're saved, but because you use Jesus' name. So there will be people who chase signs and never really get saved and never really have a relationship with God, which is the ultimate goal.
Yeah, I think too, Les, that, and Bob, that when we're spiritually shallow, we measure the value of an experience through the experience. Did I feel power flowing through me?
Mm-hmm.
Did my hands get hot? Did I get a prophetic word? Did this? And the purpose of these things is, as you say, it's an invitation to go deeper with the Lord.
Right.
And the real way to judge any spiritual phenomena is not in the moment, but in the result. You test the fruit.
Right.
For instance, you had an experience of falling under the power of the Holy Spirit and ending up on the floor. The fruit of it was your sleep disorder's gone. There was measurable fruit. I've interviewed, more people than I can ever remember about their experiences of being swooning under the power of the Holy Spirit and ending up on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And my question has always been, what did you feel? And what was the result of this experience in your life? Very few of them had no story of the result. Pretty much everybody said, afterwards, I was closer to the Lord in this way. Mm-hmm. Afterwards, I had a new hunger for his word. Afterwards, I had a new desire to pray for people. Afterwards. So when you see fruit coming from a spiritual experience like that, it validates the experience. When you don't see fruit, it doesn't mean it wasn't a spiritual experience. It means it wasn't integrated into a person's Christian life.
Right.
And there's lots of people that don't integrate these things into their lives, but you did. Mm-hmm. And when we do it, we love people more. We love his word more. We love him more. We find ourselves more zealous and passionate for him and for his kingdom. We find ourselves better people because of it. That's the fruit we're looking for,
right.
Not just the manifestations in the moment.
I always find the parable of the sower to be on point here, where people with God's word, which contains all the power in the universe, is received, there will be people who simply reject it. There will be people who take it for a short time. There'll be people who intend to keep it, but just get back to the world so much that they shelve it. It's only 25% of the people who will actually gather it in because they've softened their heart. They've asked for a relationship, and he uses that for 30, 60, 100 times blessing through those 25%. So it doesn't mean that the others can never declare his name and see a healing or a miracle, but he wants that 100 times person who's going to give their heart and hold on to that word and just do what he says.
Excellent. Let's change the subject a little bit, because I remember, first of all, being really, really excited about the physical healing gift that you were moving in. But I remember you were wanting another gift. And
right.
you often spoke to me about the gift of prophecy. You said, how come I'm not hearing from the Lord? How come I'm not getting prophetic words?
Yeah.
And you went after that gift for 2 years.
Yeah.
In my recollection, it was about 2 years of just saying, God, you've given me this healing gift and it's wonderful, but I want to hear your voice.
Right.
I want to hear your voice for other people. I want to do this prophetic ministry. You went after it and after it and after it. And then it happened. Why don't you tell us the story of your hunger for that, follow the way of love and eagerly desire spiritual gifts, especially the gift of prophecy, and how you came into recognizing his communications and giving his communications, because you've got some great stories to tell.
Okay.
About giving total strangers prophetic words.
Yeah, let me build up just a little bit, Mark. On Halloween, after the miracle in the prayer room with you, Donnett and I were invited to a party up the street in our neighborhood, and a young man who lived there had a severely broken arm in 3 spots. And as we were walking up the street, I said, well, this is going to be kind of weird. We're going to pray in front of people for a boy to be healed whose arm isn't healing and it's really got a bad break. What if it was Mark's gift in the healing room that healed all those people? What if it's not us? So we're walking up the street throwing all this doubt that, maybe because Mark was a pastor and he's got all these gifts. So we get up to that place and they bring the boy in and he sits down and we just start, asking him if he believes in Jesus. He did. And I told him that I'd seen people get healed. We were seeing between 20 and 40% of the people we prayed for getting healed. It was pretty amazing. I think God, when you first lean into him, gives you a lot of softballs to build up your faith. So we prayed over this young man and we asked him afterwards, did you feel or sense anything or see anything? And he said, I felt like boiling water was going into my arm. So, well, that's good. Usually when we see a manifestation of heat, somebody gets healed. So 2 days later, I'm at work and my wife is outside and the dad comes by and he, big guy, gets out of his car. He's got an envelope. He throws it on the hood, says he's not healed. It didn't work. And he's kind of angry, we were a guarantee or something. So she says, I'm sorry it didn't work out. And he said, I just got back from the doctors and they looked at it and he's still going to need surgery. So she called me on the phone and said, I just told him we would pray again. I don't know what else to do. And I said, that's all we can do, honey. We've seen so many people healed. We can't stop. We'll just pray again. And at that time, I was a malpractice defense attorney. So I was a medical attorney. And I just said, this is what I feel God has called us to. This is where our passion is. And we pray for people and we'll do it again. So it was about a day and a half later that the mom called and she goes, oh my gosh, Donna, I got to believe what happened. She said, after her husband came home with the x-rays, she found out he had the x-ray tech look at it, but the surgeon didn't look at it. So she took her son and the x-rays back and asked to speak to the surgeon. The surgeon took the x-rays and he's gone a little bit long. He came back and he says, well, ma'am, I need to apologize. She says, I can't really explain it, but what my tech thought were big gaping holes, you know, are really new bone growth, dramatic bone growth. I've never seen anything like this. He says, your son's healed. I can't explain it, you know. And so she just like, you know, praise God. And they cut the cast off right there. And she called us and I just laughed. I said, God, you have a sense of humor. That was medical malpractice. But we had the faith that we would pray again. And he was already healed. So that was a big kick for us.
Well, we really hope you enjoyed that interview. I know that we did. Bob, what did you think about this? Anything that stands out you want to highlight?
Well, you know, a lot of people think that people that believe in this supernatural stuff are really, what one brother said, full of out-of-Bible experiences, you know. And the thing I love about Wes and many, many people I know who believe in the supernatural in these times are people firmly grounded in the Bible.
Yeah, absolutely. I really like the part about quoted that statement by Jesus, "I never knew you," in response to these people claiming, well, we did this and we performed this miracle and we did this for you. And Jesus said, "I never knew you." And Les is reminding us that the point of these signs isn't the experience itself, but the effect it has on our relationship with Jesus. And if we keep him central, we're not going to be led astray by the gifts, no matter how wonderful they are. I thought that was really, really heartening. And then I asked him about the development of the prophetic gift in his life. And rather than answering it directly, which he'll do in our next podcast, he talked about a story I'm really glad he talked about, which was the healing of a neighbor's son's very badly broken arm. And I love the reaction of the boy's father saying, you know, it didn't work, and slamming the report on the hood of his car. And then Les and his wife talking about this failure, you know, this failure. And Les said something I think is profound. He said, "I said to her, we've seen so many healings, we just can't stop praying for the sick." And I believe that is absolutely important. At the same time that Les was experiencing his gift of physical healing, his developing ministry, I had another friend in the church, and frankly, even more spectacular healings than Les's, which is really saying something. But my other friend's first failure, where someone died rather than being healed, was his last healing experience. Mm-hmm. He walked away. He quit. And I think we have to be living beyond that. We have to be saying, you know, I've seen enough that I'll do this for the rest of my life, whether I see 100% success or not. I know that God heals and I want to be part of it, so I'm going to keep on persevering in this ministry. I think that really, Les's story really taught us something about that. And of course, he went on to have a very, very good healing ministry, which we're going to hear more about.
In fact, I hope you'll continue to listen to all of these podcasts, watch all of these podcasts, because Les has some amazing stories coming up in our next one. So be sure to join us back here. By the way, you can get our book, Reluctantly Supernatural, An Age of Reason, on Amazon and Amazon.com, or you can go to our website, reluctantlysupernatural.com. So we hope that you will continue to pursue God in these days and see his wonderful power.
Let's not stop trying. Let's keep on risking. Goodbye. We'll see you in the next one.
Amen.
You've been listening to the Reluctantly Supernatural podcast with your hosts, Mark Cowper-Smith and Bob Maddox. Be sure to check out our website at www.reluctantlysupernatural.com or visit our YouTube channel, Reluctantly Supernatural, for more videos and podcasts. To get a copy of our book, Reluctantly Supernatural in an Age of Reason, you can purchase it at Amazon.com or order it directly from us at our website, www.reluctantlysupernatural.com.